Well, hello, AP Literature class of Krum, Texas. How are you all doing? Hello, Mr. Hendrickson. Okay, as you can see, I'm floating here in the void of outer space with one purpose, and that is to answer the extensive questions that you have emailed to me. Let's get this show on the road. We're going to start with Tyler. What made you decide to write about Sherlock as an older man? Well, Tyler, I grew up reading the Sherlock Holmes stories. I was always interested in Sherlock Holmes. I was also interested in this idea of Sherlock Holmes being a real person, though he is not. And it seemed like a lot of ground had already been covered in what Sherlock Holmes had been written about in his prime, as well as a younger man. And it didn't feel like there had been too many takes or interpretations of him as an older gentleman. And because I'm interested in themes of memory and aging, he seemed like a perfect character to explore those themes with. I thought it would be interesting if you go with this idea that he was a human being, that he would also then get older, and as he got older, things would happen to him that would happen to many people as they get older. And I thought it would be an interesting thing to do. What was your message, if any, you were trying to get through to the reader? Well, there's probably multiple messages, probably some that I don't even remember. For the most part, though, I would rather the reader find their own message in it, and then and whatever that is correct, you know? I suppose if there's any one underlying big overarching message, it would be that sometimes things just happen in life that are impossible to explain. You can't attach them to reason or logic. They just occur. Good, bad, beautiful. Sometimes there's just these things. So that would be a major theme in the book. But other than that, you and whoever else has read it or is going to read it is more than welcome to find their own messages and interpret it that way, and I'm happy for that to be the case. Next question is from Luz. Would you consider making a prequel where Sherlock is a young boy? No, I wouldn't. Not that I think it's a bad idea, actually. I don't have any particular interest in writing about Sherlock Holmes anymore. However, I think it's a good idea, and I think you should write it, Luz. That should be your book, and I'll read it. I'll give you a blurb. How did I come up with the title? It wasn't the original title of the book. It never seems to fail that as a book is accepted for publication, it goes through the editorial phase, and then at the last minute, when you think everything's all done, you get a little phone call or a message from an editor or an agent, and they say, well, what do you think the title? Maybe we could change the title. So, which I'm fine with. I'm never really married to titles, so my only desire is that I get to name it. So there was a little passage in the book that mentions a slight trick of the mind, and because the book dealt with memory and the little tricks that the mind can play on us, or that we can play on the mind even, it just seemed like a good title that fit the narrative of the book. Last question, am I excited about the production? Yes, I am. I'm extremely excited about the production. I was on set in London, or in England, it wasn't all in London, this summer to watch some of the production. I got to meet Ian McKellen. He's very tall, he's very large hands. I think it's going to be a fantastic film. I'm excited to see it. So yes, I'm as excited about seeing this film as I am any film right now. So yeah. And Kaylee wants to know, do you share Sherlock's fixation on avoiding death? Well, I do want to avoid death as long as possible. However, at this age, I wouldn't say that I'm fixated on doing things like, you know, royal jelly and I would say no. I'm not as fixated on death. You mean avoiding it? That's what you said, on avoiding death. I'm not as fixated as Holmes is, but who knows, as I get older, if I get older, maybe I will be. Yeah, I'd have to quit some bad habits first. What made you want Sherlock to be old? I'll refer you to Tyler's question that I've answered earlier, but also just the idea of an old Sherlock Holmes just sounded interesting to me. because I was curious to see how this character that I love so much as a boy would grow up into an older man. And also, you know, people around me at the time I was writing it were getting older. My father was getting older. Well, we're all getting older, you know, even you're getting older. But I just, it just was a theme that interested me. If you could, would you go back and change anything in the book? Ooh. No, I don't think so. You know, I mean, maybe a word here or there. But, you know, not really. I'd have to go back and look. So I'll say no for now. Did you face any challenges in writing this book? Many personal challenges, because a lot of stuff was going on in my life as I was writing it. Book-wise, it was probably the hardest book I had written up to that time. And it was 9/11 happened right in the middle of the writing of it, and that kind of knocked it out of commission for a while. Nobody I knew who was an artist felt like doing anything creative for quite a while after that. It was just a difficult book to write, and it took a long time to find a publisher to take it. So from the time I finished, it took a long time to write it, took a couple of years to write it, and then it took another couple of years to get published, and in that time, not a lot of people were interested in this book. I have some really great letters telling me why it wouldn't make a good book. So I suppose the challenges weren't so much in the conceptualization of it, but in actually getting it out into the world. That took a while. Took a good number of years. Wyatt wants to know, why do you think that death is such a key part in many books? Well, it's the big mystery, isn't it? It's the thing that kind of unites all of us. So we're all going to have to cross that bridge at some point. And trying to understand death is a way for us to also try to understand what life is about and what it means, or if it means anything at all. Also, as we get older, we have to start dealing with the reality of death and the tangibleness of it. And as it draws closer to us, we have to deal with not only our own mortality, but the loss of loved ones and people we care about. So I think death is just one of those things, like sex and birth and marriage and all that other stuff, that unites us as humans. It's all part of the human experience. So I would probably argue that you'll find death in a lot of stuff. You'll also find probably just as much about life and love, and you know, these are just the things, the big themes that are part of the human experience. Are you planning on writing another book? If so, what will it be about? Well, good question. I don't know. We'll see. There's a couple of ideas that I've had on the back burner. I've written a couple of books since Slight Trick of the Mind, but we'll see. I'm not sure I'm at a point where I'm too comfortable talking about what the next book would be if I really intend to do it. We'll say that I you'll probably see some photo books from me and some other kind of books, but another literary novel, we'll see. It's up in the air right now. I'm just not sure. I mean, to be brutally honest, I never planned on doing this my whole life. So there's other things I have interests in. What is my inspiration for writing? Many things. Actually, anything. I mean, the initial inspiration for being a writer was other writers and books and just that experience of picking up a book and being amazed that a human being could create something like To Kill a Mockingbird or Catcher in the Rye or 1984. But, you know, when I'm writing, I'm drawing from a lot of other stuff. I'm drawing from cinema, visual art, music, photography, just all kinds of things filter in. It becomes a stew for all these other things that I'm interested in. And so just, you know, living as a creative being and you know, being open and engaged and interested, a lot of stuff inspires me, relationships, friends, you know. So it comes from all angles. More directly, more nonfiction than fiction when I'm writing fiction. Tends to be what has more of an impact on what I'm writing as a fiction writer, but that comes from all different angles. In school, was I good at English? I was really good at reading, obviously. I was good at writing. I could write a really good sentence. But I wasn't necessarily good with the grammatical side. I was innately good, you know, with writing in English because I was such a reader. And I shouldn't even admit this because my homeroom teacher for 2 years was my oldest sister. The grammatical part of English is a lot like math to me. And I'm terrible at math. So I had to really study hard. But if I had to sit down and write a good sentence, I could do it. If I had to break it down for you and tell you why it was a good sentence or what certain thing, I'm still not sure I know what a gerund is. But no, to answer your question, I was an okay English student. I was an exceptional reader. So, if I could change one thing in a slight trick of the mind, what would it be? Nothing. I'm pleased with how, you know, it's a good book. I'm pleased with it. Again, as I mentioned before, maybe a word here or there, but I'm not even sure what those words would be. But no, I'm okay. If you weren't a writer, what would your job be? A photographer? If I wasn't a writer, I've done a lot of things besides writing, and I've done a lot of things between the times I'm writing books. So I've worked in a cafeteria, I've worked in a bookstore, I had a really crappy job at a museum once. I've done any number of things. But if you mean with what would be the one pursuit I would do, photography. I love photography, so that would probably be the other thing. How often do I write? Depends. It's not all fiction, so I'm writing all the time, but it's emails and notes and, you know, things like that. I keep journals and notebooks and put ideas down in them. But as far as just writing like a novel, these days not much at all, but it comes in spurts. So, you know, when I'm doing it, when I'm writing a novel, let's say, it's every day. It's kind of a 9-to-5 gig. I get up and I do it, and then I quit at a certain time. I think about maybe 4 or 5 really solid hours of writing. How much research did you do over the Sherlock Holmes books before writing A Slight Trick of the Mind? Well, to be honest with you, I had already read all the stories. I was a Sherlock Holmes nut as a kid, so I already had a kind of experience with the books. They're kind of all in my head a little bit. So I didn't do a lot of research on the Sherlock Holmes stuff so much. But I did a lot of research on other things that involved the book. So, you know, Hiroshima, post-war Japan, memory issues, aging issues, things of that sort I informed myself about. So I did a lot of research. And then I wrote a first draft of the novel. Then I went to Japan and actually went to the places that I'd written about, because I've never been to Japan before until that time, to make sure I'd actually, you know, got the details right. So that I did that kind of research. But yeah, I like research is my favorite part of writing a book anyway. So this is a lot of reading, a lot of nonfiction, a lot of stuff about Japan, that kind of thing. Sherlock Holmes stuff, not so much until, you know, I needed to look at how Conan Doyle wrote a sentence or, you know, how he kind of did his thing. But yeah. All right. So next we have questions, a series of questions from Hunter Howard. It's a good name, Hunter. Hunter Howard. Approximately how long did it take for me to write the novel? 2 years. It took approximately 2 years to write it. Have I always been a Sherlock Holmes fan? I was a serious, serious Sherlock Holmes fan from about the ages of 11 to 13 or 14. Then puberty kicked in and I wasn't so much of a, you know, I kind of lost interest. Other things got my attention. But I've always had a fondness for Sherlock Holmes since that time. If you were to write another novel about Holmes, what would it be about? If I wrote about another elderly Sherlock, I'm not so sure there's much I could do with him other than have him decompose. So I suppose that would be it's the case of the decomposing detective. But there's not going to be another Sherlock novel for me. People have asked. I've been encouraged to do so, but there won't. If you were to write a different novel about a different fictional character, who would it be? Ooh, good question. A different fictional character. Who would it be? I would probably want to write about Seymour Glass. There you go. See if you can figure it out. And if you know who Seymour Glass is, 10 points. All right. Can our class get opening night tickets to your movie debut? Yeah, sure. No. Well, I don't know where the debut will be, the premiere, you mean. To be honest with you, I don't even get tickets. I get invited. But I'm going to say yes for now. And then, I'll let you know. But it would help out if you just bought a ticket. Because it's hard for movies these days. They need help. Anyway, nice question. Nice try, too, by the way. Go right to the author. How did you get into the mind of Sherlock Holmes, old and forgetful? I'm not so sure. That's a good question. I think it was just trying to put myself in that mindset. I will say that at the time, my father was exhibiting early signs of some of that similar kind of stuff that the Holmes character in my book was showing. So I at least had that to kind of draw from, but it wasn't easy, and I'm not so sure. I guess I just kind of focused on the details and what I imagine the thought process would be like of someone going through that. But I really don't know. That's a bit of the magic. When it works, it works, and it could have been really awful, if I had done it any differently or a different way, but I don't know. What advice would I give to an aspiring author? A few little bits of advice. Write for yourself only. Don't write out of some great desire to be a big selling author. Just write to satisfy yourself, number one. Number two, read a lot and read all kinds of different things. Don't just focus on one genre. Read for the pleasure of reading and read to be challenged. So I would say that. And then, of course, write. Imitate your heroes, and then after a point, start working on your own voice. Don't ever show your family what you're reading, especially your parents. Don't look for feedback from close friends or family members, because they know you too well, especially if they've wiped your butt or breastfed you or something like that. They can't see you any differently than as a child or their byproduct. So look for workshops, look for outside people to give you feedback. I would go along those. Don't ask me though. I'm terrible with feedback. Honestly, I'm a horrible, horrible editor. But keep working at it, and get your work out there. Blog it. Don't be precious about it, I suppose, is the other thing I'd say. But okay, the next set of questions are from Daphne. What was the exact relationship I intended between Mr. Yamazaki and Sherlock? And then, parenthetically, you wrote, failed father-son, warped mirror images, plot device, and main character. Actually, Tyler asked me what one of the messages in the book, and if I thought in terms of themes, I'll say that one of the major themes of the book is lost fathers, Roger's father, Mr. Yamazaki's father. It's a book about lost fathers and trying to find that lost father. So I would say that in that regard, Yamazaki's desire to learn about his father via Sherlock Holmes is some way of trying to recreate a father and son relationship that never existed, trying to have a relationship with his hero in a way that he never could have had with his own father, and at the same time try to find what happened to his father. So that was my main idea of that relationship. Why did you decide to have Sherlock's main motivation behind retiring as a beekeeper the interaction he had with a woman he only knew for a handful of days? That part of the book is about unrequited love. We've all had it. We've all had profound unrequited love. I'm sure many of you are having it right now. But it just seemed poignant somehow that way. Sherlock Holmes is not someone who was known to have many serious relationships with the opposite sex. Actually, not very many serious relationships with any sex. And I kind of felt that he was given this gift of having this amazing intellect, but the payoff was that it made him kind of impossible to have a serious relationship with someone. Can you imagine being in a relationship with someone like that? That'd be hell. And that's not to say that he didn't feel deep feelings for people. So, but perhaps for my version of Sherlock, there was this idea that the closest he could get to a very serious relationship with someone, in terms of romantically anyway, would be a unrequited relationship, and that he could then honor that through metaphor. And the bees are a big metaphor in the book. They're a metaphor for society. You know, they're also a metaphor for highly well-constructed organism that operates of its own accord, that tends to be devoid of emotion and emotion and feeling. And so I felt like it was also a metaphor for Holmes as well. And so he took those feelings that he couldn't quite make sense of, and he invested them into this other thing that he could at least have some understanding or feel more akin to anyway. So there you go. There's that answer. But you know what? I'm curious what you think about it. Maybe you have a different take on it. That's the power of fiction. You can interpret it any number of ways. So what is your definition of sociopath, and do you define Sherlock as one? How long did you consider your idea before beginning to write? Well, I'll answer the second part first. I considered it for a few months before I started writing it, maybe a year. It kind of ruminated around. I had a lot of notes. So, the thinking through phase was several months. At that point, I was jumping from books really fast. So I had already finished up one and already was putting my energy into outlining A Slight Trick of the Mind. What is my definition of a sociopath? I don't know. I tend to, obviously when I think of sociopaths, I tend to think of people like Ted Bundy or individuals like that. However, I feel like our society is populated with sociopaths, in all walks of life. They're not murderers or. Would I say he's a sociopath? My definition of a sociopath, no. I wouldn't necessarily say he's a sociopath. I would say that the way that Benedict Cumberbatch plays him on the Sherlock show, he does seem like a bit of a sociopath on that show to me. I think my feeling with Sherlock, he was a little more engaged in, he was pretty hip to manipulative like a sociopath can be, but I'm not so sure. I would say probably he had more of an Asperger-y kind of disposition, maybe a highly self-aware autistic side as well. But my understanding of a sociopath, I'm not so sure I would ascribe it to my version of the character. Did I ever feel discouraged in the course of writing because of flashier versions that are more popular? BBC, Warner Brothers, House MD. Well, no, actually not at all. You got to remember that, I guess the Warner Brothers, you'd mean I'm assuming, I could be wrong, but the Robert Downey Jr. Ones. All of that came after I wrote the book. So if anything, the Cumberbatch one came after the book. The book was written and finished in 2003, and I don't think it was published in 2005. So those things came long after the fact. And in fact, if anything, those things, the Cumberbatch Sherlock and the Robert Downey Jr. Sherlock, which I confess I've only seen a couple of the Benedict Cumberbatch shows, and I enjoyed them. And I had dinner with Benedict Cumberbatch, actually, when I was in England, name drop. And he was a pleasant enough fellow. But I think all of those things actually made it a lot easier for the film to get made, to be honest with you, because it meant that, whereas before there was a lot of resistance to this idea of kind of removing the character from the universe that he was associated with, suddenly here he is as a kind of superhero in the Robert Downey Jr. one, and this kind of psychic, modernized version that Cumberbatch does, and and I never even thought about House, but I suppose House is a kind of Sherlock too, isn't he? But no, I think all of those things helped. So I was never, if anything, I was encouraged by the fact that people were now playing with the versions of the character that made what I had done, you know, a decade or several years earlier, much more, you know, not considered such a risk to take. So it helped, I think it helped get the film financed, to be honest with you. Would I say my Sherlock is asexual but heteroromantic, or heteroromantic but bimantic, or, Well, he definitely, my version definitely has genitals, so he is human. I would say the first, probably. I think that he is a little more asexual, but heteroromantic. For some reason, and this isn't usually something I would have a problem with, I have a very hard time imagining Sherlock Holmes as a sexual character. Now, as a gay man, it bothered me early on when people read some kind of a homoerotic element into the relationship between Holmes and Roger, because that was never, ever, ever in my mind when I wrote it. For many reasons. One, you're dealing with a man in his 90s and a boy that is prepubescent, so that seemed absurd. My brain didn't even go there. But other people's brains went there. And also that it bothered me that you couldn't have that kind of father-son-like intimacy, which is what I actually envisioned it more as, without it being interpreted as homoerotic. So I want to dispel that. That was never in my mind. But I would say that probably asexual with heteroromantic would be more accurate for what I intended. It might have been interesting to have gone biromantic with it, but that would have been a whole other book. It would have been a slight trick or something else. But yeah, good question. I like that one. What scene in the book was my favorite to write? Oh, well, Madame Schirmer, the German music one, because it was just so absurd. And if you read it, it's a really bad German accent. I was there while they were filming that scene, and the actress that played Madame Schirmer was fantastic. It's a good scene. But I remember the time that I was actually amusing myself. My favorite parts of the books were maybe not the best writing of that book, but the part that I actually amused myself. So that's the one that sticks out as one that I enjoyed writing. The rest was pretty hard. Was the prickly Asian pear a symbol of Sherlock's loss of the craving for immortality? Well, I didn't intend it that way, but if you read it that way, I like that. So I would say if you read it that way, then it is correct. It was not my intention, but interesting. I'll keep that in mind next time I browse through the book. Do you consider Sherlock misunderstood, a smug prick, or a mixture of both? More of a smug prick, if you want to know the truth. I don't feel that he's all that misunderstood. I think when someone is misunderstood, my feeling is that when someone is misunderstood, that they're being their behavior is being misunderstood by others. I don't think in the case of Sherlock Holmes, he put out anything other than kind of a smugness that was hard to misunderstand. I mean, it was kind of just who he is. So I'd say maybe not prick, but it's, you know, kind of, well, sure, why not? Yeah, more of a smug prick. Do you like or hate the hat? You mean the deerstalker hat? The character never wore the hat. That was the creation of an illustrator named Sidney Paget, but, or was it even him? I don't even know if Paget is even the one who did it, but, I'm indifferent to the hat. I think it looks silly. I like the idea of Sherlock wearing other hats. As far as Sherlock goes, I mean, in the old black and white films, the hat looks great. I think now it looks silly. But it's really identified with him. You can't wear one of those hats without people thinking Sherlock Holmes. It's called the Deerstalker, but most people call it the Sherlock Holmes hat. But so I don't hate it. I'm not crazy about it. I'm probably more indifferent to it, but I definitely don't want it on my character, my version of the character. Okay, so next we have Riley. And Riley has two questions. Number one is, are you afraid the movie will portray the story differently than you have? Well, Riley, I've read the script, so I can tell you that there are sections that are very different than the book. But the book's the book, the film's the film. They have to condense the story into an hour and a half to 2 hour piece. You know, things change. Things get changed. But I'm, you know,
there was a film version of another book I wrote called Tideland. You know, it's just the nature of the beast. So I to be honest with you, my there are other writers who get terribly upset over these things. I don't. My feeling is I've done my work. The book is there. Whatever the film is, it will be associated with that book. And that, you know, it's people have to, in order for people to get involved in a serious creative manner in terms of making it into a film, they also have to invest something of themselves in it. And that comes down to things they feel should be in there. The director, Bill Condon, who is a fantastic man and a really nice guy, and I've you know, I know him, you know, he had ideas, and he would tell me these ideas, and I thought they were fantastic. So they added things to it, a few things that I wished I had thought about. So, for example, they have Sherlock Holmes, my Sherlock, the old elderly Sherlock, watching a film version in the 1940s of someone else playing him on the screen. I think it's a great idea. So that's something that's in the film, or, you know, hopefully will stay in the film when it's edited, that I didn't have in the book. So, no, I'm fine with the changes as long as they make sense and they're not ridiculous, you know. If a helicopter started swooping in and things were blowing up in the background, I might not be too happy about that, but I don't think that's going to be the case. But yeah. Are you afraid of negative feedback from the movie because this is not the usual Sherlock story? Luckily, Ian McKellen is starring in it, so that will absorb a lot of that kind of thing. You know, the thing is, I went through the backlash. I got some pretty nasty, hate mail, to be honest with you, through Random House when the book was published. A lot of how dare yous, and so I've already been through that. It's kind of water off a duck's back. I mean, it just doesn't bother me. There are people who read the book and love it, and there are people who've read the book and think it's just a piece of trash. I have no say in either of that. I'm happy when they like it. What can I say if they don't? So, again, you know, the film is the film. And here's the thing, if you really want to get down to it. If the film is a success, I get to reap the benefits of that. I get to say, you know, yeah, it's based on my book. If the film bombs, no one's going to be paying attention to my book. They'll be paying attention to the director, the actors, the other things. So, I'm in a good place with it, so I'm not that worried about it. But that said, I hope people go see it, I hope they enjoy it, and I hope it is a very successful, well-made product, and I feel that it's moving in that direction. So, Judith wants to know, what were the actual feelings that you wanted to be portrayed through Holmes's interaction with Miss Keller? Was it his need for company, lack of interaction with another human in search of a particular behavior, or was it love and his ability for loving? I think his need for company. I think it was also his need to try and connect with someone. And of course, it's kind of a failed endeavor, but you know, I believe that was what I was trying to do with that one. Next question, why is Holmes in such fervent need of staying alive? What is it that motivates him to keep living if he has no one to live for, such as loved ones? Well, you know, we could ask that about any of us, you know, why? I think he would probably say that he has work to do, and his loved ones are his bees and his what he's writing, and you know, this life of the mind that he has, and for him that's everything, so it's worth living for. But again, you know, we also see that his need to interact with other humans comes into it too, and maybe that's why he wants to live, so he can actually have that experience too when he hasn't really fully had it. The scene where Miss Keller is speaking for her dead children via the glass harmonica is very peculiar and unlike the rest of the book. For a majority, the book seemed to be based on logic and sense, but in this scene there are sort of mystical and inexplicable happenings. What was it that you wanted to convey through this scene exactly? Oh boy, I'm not sure I remember that as well as I should, but I definitely wanted to convey Miss Keller's kind of breakdown through her kind of sense of seeking something through the mystic, something she couldn't make sense of. So in that regard, I think it was not so much trying to create a mystical thing, but rather than to show somebody desperate for answers and desperate to connect and communicate in a way that she couldn't in the real world. So it took on this kind of odd thing. But actually, the truth is, a lot of people were doing that at that time, in that period, in the, using the glass harmonica to communicate with what they thought were dead souls. So, yeah.
Why did you decide to include the glass harmonica?
Well, it's such a weird instrument, and it's kind of an instrument no one talks about, but it was a very popular instrument. It's one of those things where I liked the idea of it, and I incorporated it into the book. So there was no deeper meaning than that. It just seemed like a nice plot device, a nice tool to use to create this kind of other dimension to the story.
Was it necessary to have Roger die in the book?
Yes.
Was it so as to prove that Holmes was different than people had expected him to be, or why?
Well, listen, part of the message in the book is that inexplicable things happen to good people. Terrible things happen to good people, and we don't always have a reason for it. So in the book, for Roger to die actually not only underlines that kind of message, but it also forces the character of Holmes to have to deal with bigger issues, the issues he's kind of been avoiding. So, and also, you know, it's an out of blue moment. You're not expecting it as the reader. And so that's why I wanted to do something that would also jar the reader to have to think and feel something as well. So it did. But again, I'm a little removed from it, but I know that I had a desire to make the book move, suddenly jolt it and jar it the way that it would jar Sherlock's character.
Logan wants to know, while reading your novel, I noticed that in the beginning there are deaths of children before they were born, and then the death of a child, then the mention of deaths of the elderly Holmes once knew. Was this intentional? If it was, did it have a deeper meaning, or did it just happen that way?
Well, I'm not sure how intentional it is, but again, lost fathers is an issue, and lost fathers and dead children. There you go. I'm not sure it was purely intentional on my part, but I'm not too sure. I mean, clearly I was stringing it together somehow. Tough one. I'm not sure. Can't remember, Logan.
Why do you have Holmes get so attached to a woman who he has never met?
Well, I don't know. I mean, because then what he's dealing with is his unrealistic projection on that woman. So she's kind of becomes a metaphor. If he knows her, then he knows too much about her. But if she's off and over there, then it's a projection of something he's kind of putting on her. We all do this. We've had crushes. You have a crush. There's somebody you really like. You're really projecting something onto them. You're creating an illusion of them that's probably inaccurate to a large degree. That's why I want it. If he had met her, plus, it created an element of mystery. There's a stalker-like quality about it that's a little creepy if you want to know the truth. It was humanizing Holmes in a way that would make him seem like a flawed, real human, doing kind of those flawed human things that certain people do, usually male, although some women do too. And so it was just, there were several things at play, but definitely my desire to make him seem somewhat desperate and yet afraid of connection.
Kelly Cousins wants to know, what's the significance of such a great emphasis on the bee apiary in the book?
Well, this is just pure fact, that in the Conan Doyle stories, Sherlock Holmes retires to Sussex and to raise bees. So it is I took that and went with it. But also the apiary is where you keep your bees. So and then the bees become a good metaphor for other things, as I've mentioned earlier. But it was just staying true to what Conan Doyle had the character do after he left his life in London as a detective. He went to be a bee farmer in Sussex, so it had to play an important part of the book. And of course, being Sherlock Holmes, he wouldn't be just a normal bee farmer. He would be deeply invested in that that preoccupation or occupation. The preoccupation of that occupation.
Why did you include the story about Mr. Yumazaki and the trip to Japan?
Truthfully, just because I was interested in post-war Japan. So I was reading a lot about post-war Japan at the time, and I wanted to work it into the book. So, and also because Japan at that moment in the time would have been in great flux. It was trying to figure out its own identity. It had just had its slate wiped clean. And it was also, Hiroshima is just kind of the epicenter for where the old world, the world that Sherlock Holmes occupied, met the new world, you know. It was the new order was established at that horrible moment. So it just seemed like a great intersection of the Victorian world with the modern world, which all of us were born into. So that's why I wanted to use that. Why didn't you make Sherlock Holmes have a wife and kids and a family? I don't know. It didn't sound interesting, right? I mean, Sherlock dad? I don't know. It just didn't seem likely to me. It would have been, Laurier King has done a good job with The Beekeeper's Apprentice. He's married in that book, and his wife, Mary Russell, is as brilliant as he is. But just didn't appeal. The solitary beekeeper kind of seemed more poetic to me. Lastly, did you enjoy writing the novel, and what was your favorite part? Did I enjoy writing the novel? Not so sure I enjoy writing novels. It's hard work. My favorite part, just the part that I feel most strong about, I think probably it's toward the end. I like the ending of the book. Not the epilogue part, but the part with Holmes on the bench up there. I think that's a nice, poignant section, and I remember writing it with a sense of feeling that the book had reached a complete kind of end. So I remember that. So, and maybe in my favorite part because it was at the end of the book after a long haul of writing it. But yeah. Okay, John. Did you grow up reading Sherlock Holmes books?
I did.
Quite a bit. In fact, I had a large collection of Sherlock Holmes, not just the Conan Doyle stories, but other versions, pastiches. I was a big collector.
And how did you learn details about beekeeping?
Research. Once I determined that beekeeping was going to play a large part of the book, I then went out and bought a lot of books on beekeeping and started reading them and looking at them and trying to inform myself about beekeeping. So it was just a matter of research, you know. Want to put it in the book, want to know as much about it as possible. So that was it. So there you go. Thank you for all the questions. You guys are clearly very bright. You clearly know the book better than I do. And this was fun, but it's really hot here. Take care, you guys, and, all right, I'll see you later. Bye.